bash started with a couple of mates enjoying a couple of beers. Their idea, to spend a couple of weeks driving the Outback in old cars. 3 years down the track, the bash has grown to 130 crazy crews who will cheat, bribe and battle their way from Bondi Beach in the south to the balmy Barrier Reef in the north.
Welcome to the universe. Take a bite for the biggest show in town. Welcome to the universe. Better hurry cause there isn't too much time. To see the stars fall down.
Normally the chill of winter would keep the people away from Bondi Beach at this time of the year. But the chance to mingle amongst the eccentric crews and their weird and wonderful old cars proved too much of a temptation for the thousands who turned out to wave bon voyage to this madcap and somewhat bizarre convoy.
I recommend it, I really do. Before being hard drawn, I really do recommend it.
You're taking it very seriously. Look, life's a bubble.
Out the way. So we're now back on some sort of semblance of starting order. Yes? Bourke. Yeah, turn around, go that way.
Alright.
And then head due south.
John, you almost look like you know what you're doing.
Almost, Gerald, but I think that's unfair. No one meant to know what they're doing in this battle. Unfortunately, someone has tried to organise this chaos just to get us out of here. Because you can see there are a lot of people, even more cars. But the whole thing is, it's a great day, it's a lovely place to be, and we're having fun.
This is the biggest tune I've been part of for a long time.
It is great, isn't it? I mean, really is fantastic. And some of the cars are just brilliant. I mean, so big that you had to move the starting line. How often do you move the starting line to get the cars through, for God's sake?
The car's got a chance this year. I mean, they're all going to get lost again. We're going to come through flying colours again.
Top of the line, be route instructions, OK? Good luck, Richard.
It seemed each entry was out to win a prize for the craziest farewell. As they said goodbye to the seaside and headed for Bourke and the official start. The run through the city jolted the odd fond memory of the good old Red X trial days for many suburban motorists. In reality, the only common bond between those rather serious rally days and this modern day version was the fact that the cars were of about the same vintage.
Off to the corner and round the bend. Ride to the juke, don't you go in.
The fleet of 130 all made it safely over Blue Mountains and out onto the plains country, sweeping through Dubbo, Wellington, and finally eating up the kilometres to the start line at Bourke. As night fell, the slower entrants, like Peter Lehman's 1929 Buick, the car that won last year's rally, lumbered on into the dark. The next bright spot would be at the dinner table and the day's debriefing.
Officials somewhere, so please, for our sakes as much as your own sakes, let us know when you check in, if you come in after checkpoint.
Getting into Bourke was easy. Getting out was going to be another matter. Waiting beyond the dinner trestles were the local cops, determined to raise money for charity as only the police know how.
You've got to get a new Outback license, $20 out the back, see the gentleman with the constabulary out there, or you won't get out.
Madam, if you have four in the car, there's four licences, otherwise you won't cross the bridge. Next victim is...
For a little extra cash, the police would extend the long arm of the law to embrace those who hadn't greased the right palms. Tactics are important in this game.
You'll hold him for at least 20 minutes.
20 minutes tomorrow morning, and that makes sure that you get a bit of a cheat on him, that you get away. And
does he get a fine? I hope he gets a fine.
He has to pay $50 to get himself let out.
But on this bash, the coppers could only stay bored long enough for the dust to settle in the rally's wake. This wouldn't be the last time the drivers ran foul of the Aussie police.
We're going to Gaduga tomorrow. 8 o'clock will be the first car away. Please cooperate with the officials. Once again, we'll have a graded list of how you're going to start. Bribery will get you everywhere. And good luck for tomorrow. It's very wet, very slippery, but isn't that what you all came for? Right, thank you.
Day two, the official start. The end of months of preparation. All this tender, loving care, getting these bush bashers ready, would mean nothing if a kangaroo, stray bull or scrub turkey got in the way. The late misty rain had the crews in two minds as to what lay ahead once the bash left the luxury of bitumen roads. As the leaders of the pack hightail it towards Charleville, the rest slip-slided to a sinking stop. Sheets of rain had turned the bush-red roads to a sea of mud. For the locals, the long drought had finally been broken.
I think we've got a major problem, quite frankly. There are the route instructions quite specifically. You set out one road to go down on the Langboy road up to Gaduga. One of the two-day FM cars got through to Gaduga, so we know the road was passable, as our sweet Biggle said. What happened was, the first guy has misread the route instructions. He has gone on a middle road, which we had no idea what it's like at all, and everyone has just followed him. That if they'd followed the route instructions, they would have got through with a bit of mud, but they've now gone into areas which are uncharted, and I believe even some of them have gone down to Brewarrina. So at this stage, we may well have cars scattered over an area of about, a couple of hundred miles, all in black mud and soil.
I love a sunbird country, a land of sweeping plains, of rugged cliffs and mountains, of droughts and flooding rains. I love a far horizon, I love a dual sea, a beauty and a terror, the wide brown land for me. Before I get in.
The heavy weather put pay to any more bush bashing for this day. Organisers redirected the cars up the highway to Cullamulla. Highway? That's a joke. For most of the journey, the road had looked more like a canal. Well, there it is, the last of the cars being towed through a horror stretch. And remember, this is the alternative route. This was the safe way to go. So goodness knows what the field have been through, but we've just spent 3.5 hours coming something like 600 metres. The mud is just so thick, and thanks to the army and the brigade of four-wheel drive vehicles, we wouldn't have got through. So now it looks like a warm shower and maybe even a bed tonight. The downpour, the drenching and the distance had taken its toll on the crew. But come Charleville, there was still little relief. Finding somewhere anything but soggy to bed down was a problem. For most though, comfort went out the window. Morning on day three and the low grey canopy of the past 2 days lifted. And with it, raised the spirits of the competitors. The locals hadn't seen rain for 2 years. We had yet to see the true spirit of the bash. As with the sunshine, the mood changed.
And there are two abandoned cars. Howard Lawton, you'll be probably delighted to know they are in fact the 2 FM crew.
The eerie Outback early morning light exposed the bizarre fleet as they readied for the day's battle. Car 107, a Valiant. No foxtails on this one. Car 48, the colourful 1964 Chevy Hearse, dead set, ready to go. Car 35, or is that bus 35? The old school special.
Oh, wow, we've got people making it.
This is the original Boost Bus. There is no other Boost Bus like this one, and we have absolute pleasure with this one. No flashing blue lights, no cowardice shown when anyone approaches this bus.
Dust in your eyes. We're close to the North Road tree and we're out on the track. We're sure that we'll get there and we hope we'll get back.
Where's the dust? Who's got the dust?
Cab had been designed for 5 miles an hour in the Kensington peak hour. The crew, who had never seen Australia before, were designed for the weak English sunshine. Somewhere along the Euston Road, they had made a sharp left and ended up 12,000 miles away, between Charleville and Windora. Had the meter been running, it would have been a fare about which cabbies dream, and still more than 2,000 kilometres to go. The brilliant blue sky combined with the smooth red road was almost enough to lull a driver into a false sense of security.
We don't want to be the fastest, we just want to enjoy ourselves. We're just being pulled over by the police.
Good morning.
You been drinking this morning?
Absolutely not.
Have you? Have a blow anyway. Blow one continuous breath until it's fully inflated. The idea is to build a bag up.
I've tried.
Oh, I've got a smoke here.
That'll have to do.
You haven't been drinking. You've got to be fined for not drinking.
Do I?
Yeah, you'll have to be fined for not drinking.
What's that going to cost me? $25?
Yeah, $5 will do.
Hold on.
Where'd you stay last night?
At the hotel.
Charleville?
Yeah.
What's the name of the publican?
Oh.
Geez, you did have a big night. I've only been drinking his grog for 7 hours.
John?
No, Bevan.
Oh.
Continue forking.
What's that going to... Oh, God. Is that going to get me out of trouble, do you think?
That'll get me out of trouble all the way to Windora.
Fantastic. I'd like to say that the Charleville police are very corrupt.
Thank you very
have a good
much.
Day.
But she was right. Never trust a Charleville policeman. Even if he's only wishing you a nice day. Just up the road, expectations of some serious driving were dashed.
Yeah, yes, you go up to the community hall at the end here, get your sandwiches and then sit down in the sun and enjoy them till 2 o'clock when we hope we've worked out a new route for you. And it should be a dirt route. But at the moment, Jan's bogged out there, so I'm not sure if you're going dirt route or not.
Right.
But don't go without being checked out again.
Okay, thank you very much.
Most competitors took the advice and enjoyed lunch in the tiny township. While out in the mud, Jan's misfortune meant that the cars would have to stick to that thin ribbon that wound its way through the newly wet countryside. United. It was dark when the cars finally saw civilization again. The tiny hamlet of Windora. It's a one pub, one petrol pump, one general store town.
You know, there's something about a country general store. They've really got something for everybody on the shelves. This one's at Windora. The population approximately 65, and I say approximately. Well, something happened here tonight. Adrian Cooney, who is the proprietor of this store, had one of the rally drivers come in from the Bourke to Cairns bash. He'd broken his car out on the highway. It was a Dodge, an old Dodge, and he needed something to run in. Well, Adrian came up with it. Out off the shelf, his family Holden. So the Dodge is now on its way back to Sydney on a truck. Adrian organised that, and the boys are on their way to Cairns in the family car.
Oh, well, they put the piston through the block or something on their old Dodge and came in looking for a car, so I said, oh, well, I got a car here, they can have it. A personal sacrifice to me, I reckon.
And what's the family think about losing the family car?
Oh, I don't be real worried.
What do you think of these fellas? Do you think they're a bit crazy, the things they do?
Oh, we've seen them here before. They're a good bunch of bloke, really. Business-wise, they're excellent.
Now, you know that they're going to paint the car black.
What, my car?
Yeah.
Now he tells us.
Nah. Oh, well, it won't worry me. There's plenty more cars, isn't there?
Day 4, Windora to Longreach, and at long last the Queensland Sunshine State was living up to its name. At the start line, everyone was relaxed and looking forward to finally having the chance to push their cars through some tough rally sections.
It's a very muddy section. It's the second boggy patch, and just be a bit careful. Apparently, they don't really know how bad it's going to be. So,
if we don't do anything, we'll have a good time anyway.
10 minutes out, this harsh landscape would show us who was boss.
We just went off the road and straight into the drain. We're up to our doors in mud.
What about the cars that have taken the flatter section? Are they going to be okay?
Well, they've got no idea which way the road goes. Yeah. They could end up in Birdsville.
They might have named it the Bourke to Barrier Reef Bash. It certainly sounded more glamorous than what was rapidly turning into the bog to bog.
Hell of a way to start the morning.
Oh, terrific, mate. A good shot.
Just too fast?
No, there's three or four guys standing on the road here, and I kept over this way to miss it. Only took a little bit off there, you can see where I've come off. Just caught on the left-hand front wheel and just pulled it straight into the drain.
Out here, there isn't much room for experiment, and it wasn't long before the trailblazers came to a sticky end.
Margaret and Terry, come in. Margaret and Terry, I need you.
Run faster, I need you.
Guys, I got you through the bog.
I'll take you to drive later on, mate. I'll teach you how to drive, all right?
If there's one thing that strikes you in this outback country, it's how quickly the situations can change. Just minutes back, the convoy had to depend on a grader to get them through. Now only a few k's down the road and the first hit of dust trail. But that was short-lived. We'll be right back.
amazing country we live in. Look at that, the mud on my boots hasn't even had time to dry yet. We've only travelled about 15 kilometres. Now we're on this hard packed surface, which is throwing up a little bit of dust and a little bit of mud as well. The tough boys are really going fast now as they make their run to Longreach. Hours of hard motoring had the competitors at the small railway siding of Yarraka, a typical outback town where it's hard to tell where the main street starts and ends.
Where do we go?
There's the shop up there.
Okay.
I'll come back and see if you've got water.
Will do.
The school kids were given some time off as the rest of the residents gathered at the general store where the circus had come to town. Leaving Yarraka and heading for Longreach was supposed to be a dry run, but Mother Nature doesn't always tell the truth. You guessed it, 20 minutes out, it was another chance to play in the mud.
Keeping dry and keeping your feet clean has been a bit of a problem. So over here we have our drying compartment where we keep everything nice and dry. It's the best place to dry them out.
Is she just coming?
First the car wash, then the crew wash. The drivers were almost as shiny as the cars at Longreach's big night at the original Qantas hangar. It was black tie and a little black humour.
$560 for the fur. It is a coffin. You'll never ever buy one. You'll never ever see one if you do die. $560 is there. $560.
The biggest prize of the night hadn't seen the light of day for 35 years. Until found amid the junk in a Longreach garage, the original 1952 Red X trophy. The morning after, no time for hangovers, just a good old-fashioned country breakfast at the Stockman's Hall of Fame. Route instructions on day five were becoming bizarre. Down Galar Street, past the corner of Duck and Eagle, left from Swan into Crane, and finally out on Falcon, then straight for 400 kilometres. Half an hour out of town and there it was again, the Outback red light, mud. This time the entire mobile traffic jam wasn't risking it. It was back to the main highway. Just out of Longreach, and just over 1,000 k's to go. The tailenders were still making their way back from the mud stop. The alternate route would take them on to Mutterborough and into Hughenden for the night.
Now, guys, we go down the bitumen. How long, Phil?
To Mutterborough, mate.
To Mutterborough. Then they go sort out from Mutterborough on where we go.
Meanwhile, the rally races had itchy feet and were already hitting the first of the homestead gates. And there'd be plenty of those to open and shut today.
Go, boys!
Have a good trip, Russell.
Life in the outback is lived at a slower pace. Out here, where the kids have only read about traffic in books, the bash provided the perfect opportunity to see life in the fast lane. The light was fading into a kaleidoscope of colour as the cars made their way into town.
Just take it easy, Barry. Take it easy. Keep going, but just take it easy, okay? Quite safe.
Okay. Late in the evening, the cars were still coming.
What happened back there? It seems to take ages to come down.
Oh, we were stuck up here. That was a bit of light trouble, generator trouble. They're coming all the time. They're stuck down the road and broken down.
Are you having fun?
Oh, yeah.
Bad weather was well behind, but not so the rough road. Ahead lay 450 kilometres of bumps and jumps. At long last, the chance to get into a bit of true rally driving. As the gas pedals went down, the revs crept up. It seems that the old thoroughbred was made for these roads. She sits rock steady while the wheels eat up the bumps. They reckon riding in her is like sleeping in an iron frame waterbed. They'd survive the drenching, the driving, and the mud. After 3,500 kilometres, old iron was beginning to tire, just when they'd finally made it to the dry stuff. The Buick finally joined the list of wheeling wounded. Like all finely tuned athletes, old Father Time eventually creeps up. But she is in good hands. Dr. Peter Lehman supervises the operation from the driver's seat.
You'll be right, mate.
Kilometers to go and you could almost smell the sea. The Oasis provided food, water and a place to repair cars that planned obsolescence should have taken care of 10 years earlier. But some competitors had more pressing concerns.
Peter and I are just discussing which wine will go with this meal. I'm more in favour of the Chardonnay, but Peter being an expert winemaker, can we have your views, Peter, on which wine you would like to present with this meal?
Oh, especially the tail end up to the middle section is definitely a Rhine Riesling. And then when you get to from there upwards, definitely either Chardonnay, the white drinker's red, or Pinot Noir. And then right at the end, the dry Semillon. I'll just finish it off.
That's excellent. The head's still in good shape, but it's good. It's going to be brilliant eating.
About third there and about 2 mile out, bang, tie. We were flying, he was going beautiful. Bloody hell, you could hear it. We only made it 50 yards up here, another tie.
What do you call it?
Bang, tie.
Another tie.
Another
tie.
Come on.
A bit more close.
Come on, Spinard, you've had all the training. You can dig one 6 foot.
John's gone into bloody Birmingham.
Is he?
Unbelievable burial.
Yeah.
Richard, why'd you leave the door open?
Stoddard's got in there.
It cuts off half the bloody road.
You got those two tubes, John?
We've been going fine. We really have been impressed with the way it's gone. Everything until we got just out of town here today, and it started to miss a bit, so we stopped and discovered one of the wires and the distributor was a bit loose, tightened it up, set off again. Hadn't gone more than about 5 k's, and all of a sudden it died. Just stopped. So we brought it into town, towed it in, and a guy pulled up in a Falcon and said, that's a Buick, isn't it? My brother's just sold one. And we said, yes, we think we've got troubles. He said, well, look, give him a ring in Cairns, gave us a phone number, drove out, and we found that there was two virtually identical cars, 10 k's just down the road here at Battle Creek. So we're heading off down there tonight to salvage and scrounge a few bits off that. He's given us permission to take them, so we think we've had a lucky run.
Mount Garnet on the final morning of the event was a scene of mixed emotion. For some, Cairns couldn't come quick enough. But for most, the thought of the bash ending brought a twinge of sadness.
There are a lot of cars that just aren't going to make it to Cairns, and a lot of them are smashed, so we're feeling pretty pleased with ourselves.
Over the past week, all had experienced a camaraderie that only comes with this type of marathon event.
You must have been under the weather, mate.
He was blind when he said
he was ready to go.
This last rally section into Mareeba had the Fair Dinkum drivers excited. There was 40 k's of hairy road winding down from the high country that would test everybody's courage to the limit.
After we get off the hairy stretch of road, the rally road, we're fine. But on that section of road, the rally section, no overtaking.
Okay.
You are
Let's join the eventual winner, Dave Hanlon, inside his 64 EH Holden as he throws the Holden down the last section. But if the bash had a mystery, it was the riddle of the London cab. For them, it was peak hour pace all the way. Yet in a field of 130, they were somehow running in the top 10. This clearly wasn't a case of driving to win. This was conniving to win.
We've just been caught.
Devious
bastards. Yes, devious.
No, devious.
So we have the fingerprints. We have the clue. You're stumped.
Thank you.
We've been sort of cheating for the past 5 days.
Yeah, we've just been caught.
They haven't caught us for 5 days. We've been cheating every day, and today we've had to allow ourselves to be caught.
Somehow, these devious British people in their London taxi have got hold of an entire second set of time cards. They've actually been marking the time cards out with a time that suits them. And that's put them up in the top 10, up against some of the fastest Holden drivers and Volvo drivers this country's produced. And there's the old London taxi. And I mean, 102 is bribing, but car 20, the London taxi, without paying any money at all, is still managing to get up there by a very devious, dishonest cheating.
The final checkpoint, Mareeba, where all the cars were to meet and assemble for the grand parade into Cairns. If there was one thing you could expect in this year's bash, it was the unexpected. When most had thought the drama was over, this mob of dinky dyes turned on a real Aussie welcome to the North Country. The parade was a show of triumph, not just for the competitors, but mainly for the old cars that had held it all together over some of Australia's roughest terrain. Home and hose safely in Cairns, once again the star of the show was the remarkable 29 Buick of Peter Lehman. This year's run had fully tested the old girl and her crew. But against all odds, this odd couple made it to the delight of everyone.
Well done.
Well done.
Go on, you Phil.
You got the timing to go.
When the organisers had said back at Bondi all those kilometres ago that the finish was to be on the Barrier Reef, they weren't joking. The race might have started beside the Pacific Ocean, but let me tell you, it finished in it.
Spit the dummy prize, please.
as we approached the tree, a bull came out with his head down and his backside up. The score finished up with the bull one and the EH none.
Last year, he put his sideways through Hungerford and took a great chunk out of his rear end. This year, he finally got it right. He injured one of his passengers. He put his sideways onto a rock, ripped out the front end, but apart from a bit of stump rattle and what's that between friends, George Bevan is still going. George Bevan, come and collect your prize as the clumsiest driver.
Muffler, clutch, windscreen, first gear, second gear.
Dozens of sleeping kangaroos along the road.
The road from Windsor to Isisford was a little bit, how should I say, not made, unbitumised, not tarmac, or muddy.
Just trying to dig the other blinker, I can't find it. See you somewhere right now.
Yes, sir.
Hi, I'm Tony Packard. Look, I don't know where I am.
In, over, in. Back again, but you get that.
And this is where we put the shampoo for the conditioner. For the we thought of that one ourselves actually, without any help.
Okay, the ultimate cheese. Well, the ultimate cheese, I'm afraid to say, these people set out with this one aim in mind, and that was to be the ultimate cheese. Janice, the trophy's still there because they put in meat there as well. But I reckon these guys need three cheers for doing having the tenacity and guts to do the London Taxi and raising money. Hip hip, hooray!
This has been another presentation from 9.